With Straight Smile Solutions, straightsmilesolutions.com, and today we're going to talk a little bit about the My Phase 1 Smile Index, which is a screening form that I developed a few years ago. It had been kind of a brainchild of mine for over a decade, and now it's readily available on our website, straightsmilesolutions.com. You can find it under Store, under Documents. It's also free for anyone that becomes a Straight Smile Solutions client, be it a VIP or concierge. Just let us know if you want a copy of it. But we're always doing giveaways on podcasts and things for it, so just listen for it and listen for the keywords, how to get one for free. But in any case, I wanted to tell you a little bit about why we developed it and how to use it. So part of the reason why I developed this forum was just out of frustration, a couple fold. And by the way, the comments I'm going to say here are only the opinions of myself and of Straight Smile Solutions. They are not the opinions of any of the United States orthodontic community besides myself. There may be other people that have this opinion, but I'm just going to tell you my own opinions. I get some hate mail a lot, so I just want to make sure I clarify they're my opinions and no one else's. But I got frustrated when I was practicing. I got frustrated at seeing teenagers coming in who are done growing, you know, and if you haven't listened to a lot of my other 6,500 videos that are out there, I have huge playlists just on phase one, interceptive, airway, over, I think almost 200 videos just on that, everything you could think of. And by the way, if I'm forgetting something, let me know because I'll make that video. I'm constantly taking suggestions and I add like several videos a week. By the way, if you want to access those, that entire playlist, the easiest way to find it is to go to my website, straightsmilesolutions.com, look for educational videos. But if you go to YouTube, you can just go to Straight Smile Solutions and the playlists are all on the homepage. But in any case, I got frustrated because I would see these teenagers coming in, you know, and you know, the way that dentists are trained, they're supposed to send all patients to ortho at age 7, right? There's little pamphlets that are in every office that say that. The AAO says that. Does it happen? No. Rarely. Why? Well, because the general and pediatric dentists don't always know why. You know, they just say you need to go because you're 7. They don't say why. What's going to happen if you don't go? And unless we are educating every single primary care dentist that's out there in the whole world on the why behind it, each particular situation, which is basically teaching them orthodontics, you know, phase one orthodontics, they're not going to be able to explain the why. So it's very difficult to get that patient in their busy schedule, or they might be afraid that it's going to cost a lot of money. They just can't afford it. They don't even want the information. They don't want to know. They don't want to take the time. They think it's expensive to go. Usually the consults are free. So they don't go. And they wait till the child has all their teeth in or until it looks like there's a problem, which is often too late once you get to that point. We can't always fix things properly. We have to fix things compromised, or maybe we wouldn't have had to pull out teeth, but now we have to pull out teeth because you waited too long. You know, we could have done something super easy and low cost and simple and not painful when they were younger, but now it's too late, right? Because the child is done growing. So, and just to get back on my soapbox about the three different ages, let's talk about the three different ages. Every child that's out there in the whole world has three different ages. You're like, what? No, they have one age. No, they have three ages. They have their age. The age on their birth certificate, they are 8 years, 2 months. You know, that's what their birth passport says. That's when they were born. Great. That's their age. That's their chronological age. But they have two more ages. They also have a dental age, okay? And the dental age very much might line up with their chronological age. You know, if we read, you know, orthodontic textbooks or pediatric dental textbooks, it says what you're expecting at age 8, age 7, which teeth come in when. So, you know, we have people who are more developed dentally and less developed dentally. I mean, I was hecka slow with my teeth. I don't think I lost my first tooth till I was almost 8. I might have been 8. Might have been 8 and a half. I was really slow. I was in third grade when I lost my first tooth. I don't think they all came in till I was almost 4. I was in high school when they all came in. That's how slow I was. So my dental age was really slow, really behind my chronological age. There are definitely kids. I remember in my daughter's class, she had third graders who were 8. Who had lost all their teeth. And then there were 8-year-olds who'd lost no teeth yet, okay? That's what I mean by dental age. We have a dental age, we have a chronological age. Then we have a skeletal age. Skeletal age is the physical maturity of our bones and our bodies. There are 8-year-old girls who are done growing. And there are 8-year-old boys who are nowhere near growing. They may not finish growing till they're 20, or 19, you know, they're still hitting their growth spurt in college. They're definitely kids like that. You know, it's all over the spectrum. And if you have kids or if you're a teacher or, you know, a physician, you know this. So it gets complicated with ortho because we have to take all three of those ages into account when we create a treatment plan. It's actually not complicated, but it is, okay? Because if you misguide and the patient does not go at the right time, the timing all comes into play. All those three ages comes into play when you're developing the timing for orthodontics and when to start. You may not have a positive outcome or an ideal outcome, or it's a compromised outcome, or it's not going to look as good, or it's not going to function as good, or it's more painful and more complicated. We have to do surgeries. We have to pull out teeth. You know, nobody wants to do any of that if we don't have to, right? But this all comes down to educating the primary care dentists. I mean, I think there's something close to 1 million primary care dentists in the world, last I heard. I mean, a lot. How much do they actually learn in dental school about phase one orthodontic screening? None, zero, zilch, nothing. They know nothing. They know nothing. You have to go to residency to learn that. You either have to go to orthodontics residency or pediatric dentistry residency. That's when you're gonna learn it. And it's highly unfortunate. So for that reason, I got frustrated and created this system, which I'm gonna get to a little bit more later, because it's a take-home system where you can make a score, be it a score of 1 or a score of 80, that talks about how severely they need phase one orthodontics. It was designed for a 6 to 9 year old, but you know, if they have any permanent teeth in, go ahead. If they have, you know, they have baby teeth in, go ahead. You know, take the screening form. You can send it home with the parent and the patient. They see their score, they know how urgent it is, and now it's something that tangible, that's quantified, that they can take and show the other parent, show the aunties and uncles, you know, and they understand the urgency of why they need to get started. And that's why I created it. So in any case, it is something that we do teach, and we'll be glad to teach any dentist that's out there. Our sessions, you can become a concierge client for just a month and we'll teach you. You'd also just book, you know, hour-long sessions with us, and we'll be glad to teach you it. And we're glad, you know, to do webinars to teach it. If you have a large group of dentists that can get together for a study club, if it's enough to make it worthwhile, you know, we often can do these for free. Because it is so critically important to me to teach this to as many primary care dentists as possible, to help as many kids as possible. And I know you guys think that's nuts, but that's part of my mission statement in life that I have really decided to focus on. There's a lot of orthodontists out there helping general dentists with their Invisalign treatment plans, but there's pretty much nobody doing this. So, that's my goal. And I'll be really honest, I'm going to tell you a couple secrets, orthodontic secrets. And again, this gets into the whole, these are my opinions and only my opinions, and I don't want to hate mail kind of thing. But I've been to a lot of AAOs, which is American Association of Orthodontics. And I hear a lot of stuff, you know, it's a real old boys network, you know, highly underrepresented in minorities, was initially highly underrepresented in females, and some of the stuff you hear is just disgusting. But in any case, some of the stuff makes me so mad that I hear. And one of the things that I heard was, you know, you should never teach a primary care dentist or a GP or a pediatric dentist how to screen for phase one, because what's going to happen is then they're going to want to do it. Yeah, they're going to want to do it because it's heck of fun to do phase one. It's the best ortho out there. I mean, listen to my 200 videos on phase one treatment and interceptive treatment and growth modification and growing jaws and expanding palates and how fun it is. It's so super fun. I can talk about it for hours. But this is how disgusting it gets. They're going to want to do it. And if they do it, they're going to realize how easy it is. And we're really the smartest. We're the smartest dentists that are out there. We're the orthodontists. We're the ones that had to get the best grades. We studied the most, so we earned this, you know? We earned this. We have the right to take these patients. And it's like, what? You own these patients? Since when should we stop people from learning? And it gets even worse. This is stuff I've heard, okay? Like I said, my opinion, only things I've heard. It's probably not all orthodontists that are out there. But The reason why we don't want to teach primary care dentists how to do phase one treatment, not only because they think that they own the patients, it's their right, because it's their specialty, but because they're going to realize how easy it is, they're going to want to do it, and then we're going to lose that referral. Better to just wait, and this is even worse. This even blows my mind. Sometimes there's one orthodontist I heard say this. Sometimes I choose not to do phase one treatment and tell the parents it's not needed when it kind of is, because I know I could handle this in comprehensive treatment if they wait a few years. And if I do the phase one now, I'm only going to get $2,000 or $3,000 for the case, and I could get $7,000 later. Okay, that's disgusting. Oh, it gets better. And then I know that if I only get $2,000 or $3,000 for doing the phase one, then now the patient may not even need phase two. Bing, 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 bing. I just said something you don't know. Quite often, if you do the phase one, I cannot make any promises. But remember, what is phase one treatment, right? Phase one treatment is the fixing of the bite, the airway, and as needed, aligning the front teeth. For me, the aligning the front teeth can be cosmetic, or it could be related to function if we needed to, say, do a 2x4 or a phase one aligner to close 7 through 10, upper 2 to 2, max 2 to 2, so that the canines aren't impacted or something like that. Okay, that's related to function. So that's phase one treatment. We fix the bite, we fix the transverse, we fix the vertical, we fix the AP, right? Over bites, under bites, over jets, negative over jets, deep bites, open bites, habits, airways, transverse issues, narrow palates. That's phase one, right? Super fun stuff. So if I do the phase one now, I'm only getting $2,000 or $3,000. Now they might not even need phase two, which is totally true. Many, many times I've done phase one and they didn't need phase two. Sometimes it was just perfect. You know, if you build it at all, sometimes you have teeth come in straight and they're perfect, right? You just need a new retainer. Sometimes you don't. Sometimes there's some little twists and turns. I can't predict. We've got 12 more teeth. Well, not even 12. We've got 12 plus 4. So we got 16 more teeth coming in, right? Threes, fours, fives, threes, four, fives, and all four quadrants plus sevens. So those are the teeth we're still waiting to come in. 16 more teeth to come in. You know, usually when you fix the bite and you expand the arches, if you do it properly, usually the 16 teeth come in properly. Can't promise, you know? I did phase one of my daughter. Looked pretty darn perfect at age 8. What happened? There was an impacted canine. Plenty of space for it to come in. Still was impacted. That's just how it is, okay? So, can't promise. I did phase one on my son. Didn't need phase two. Ah. Upper right two, number 7, is probably rotated 5 to 6 degrees. I mean, I see it. He doesn't care. He doesn't want it. He's almost an adult. His choice. I don't really care. So, yeah. So then we're only getting $2,000 or $3,000 instead of $7,000 or $6,000 for the treatment, and or the general dentist might notice it's a really easy Invisalign Light or Go case, and they might do the phase two. So essentially, we're only getting half the money, and that's going to ruin our profession, and we're going to be losing a lot of income. So for that reason, not only should we as a profession not do phase one unless absolutely necessary, which I think is disgusting, even if the parent asks for it, telling them they don't need it, but we also shouldn't teach anyone else how to do it or just explain what it is. That, when I heard that, and I don't remember which AAO this was at, I don't remember who it was, but I've heard this on more than one occasion. I even heard it in my own residency by one somebody, and I'm not going to say who it was. So I was flabbergasted. I mean, that's just wrong on so many levels. It is disgusting. It's embarrassing. And for that reason, I said, forget this. I'm going to create a form and I'm going to give it to as many people as I can, as many dentists as I can. As a matter of fact, if consumers want to have it, great. You can probably Google it and find it. Okay. Bring it to your dentist and tell them to use it. I want you to, because I want as many patients as possible who are under age 10 to get the treatment that they need, so that we don't have to pull teeth out, so that we don't have to do surgeries later, so that we don't have adults with OSA. You know, I can't promise it's going to happen, but it's certainly going to make it better. It is the best way to help the health of your patient. As general dentists, we get adults who have periodontal disease. They have this, they have that. and a vast majority of a lot of their restorative and perio issues is due to malocclusion. Why don't, instead of just fixing the malocclusion, let's prevent the malocclusion. Let's start early. And matter of fact, you know what? You can start even earlier than six. There is so much stuff you can do at age 2, 3, 4, 5, and it's fun and easy. I mean, from habit elimination to different types of appliances just to help, you know, get rid of oral habits, tongue issues. There's just so much you can do. So anyways, I'll get off my soapbox, but now you understand the why of why I created this document and why I want every dentist to know how to use it. And happy to talk to you. If you have a big enough group to create a big enough webinar, I will indeed do it for free. So just give me a buzz. It's worth an ask, right? All right. Thanks so much.